Movies can give us the opportunity to get away from the everyday problems that we have in personal life and work, but they can also take us to pretty damn dark places that will leave us scarred and thinking, what the hell did I just watch? And that had to be the case with 1996 Fargo, which the three of us had never watched before. This is a classic movie directed by the Coen brothers about a desperate man that will do whatever it takes to obtain some much needed money. And let's just say that he's desperate enough that he's willing to have his wife kidnapped purposely. He's coordinating this. But let's just say that things don't go according to plan, because how can that go right, right? You know, talking about your wife being stolen and then you've got a little bit of money because your father-in-law is rich and you want to take advantage of that. So we're going to be talking about the 1996 classic movie on another exciting episode of A Cast to the Past, where you can check out a brand new episode each and every Sunday talking about the terrible and incredible movies and games from the 80s, 90s, 2000s with yours truly, Juan Velez from San Juan, Puerto Rico. And joining me as always, we have the man that selected this movie, because everything that we're going to talk about is made possible by Ryan McNulty from Boston, Massachusetts. So Mr. McNulty, I got a question for you, buddy. Mm-hmm. What made you choose Fargo? Because this is not like other movies that we've talked about before.
So I was looking up some 90s movies, top 90s movies that I wanted to cover. And looking through that list, Fargo came up, and it reminded me of back when this movie came out. I never saw it, but I remember my father and my sister talking about it all the time. I think a lot of the accents and stuff were definitely very memorable, but also just kind of talking about it as this black comedy, sort of. It's funny, but it's serious. So, at the time, I'm sure I wouldn't have really been able to appreciate it as a kid, but kind of seeing that movie and be like, I remember hearing about this, but I never saw it. So I think it's time to finally see this movie.
And then joining us, we have somebody that he can really give us a cultural perspective, or at least I'm really hoping so, because from London, Ontario, we have Keith Pushek. And Keith, I got to ask
me.
You something.
Yes.
Because you know that Ryan is the person that selected the movie, what do you want to say, not about the movie, what do you want to say to Ryan right now? This is your chance.
Why? what traumatic experience happened recently that you're like, I need to share the pain with everyone here?
Well, to be fair, I knew nothing about what this movie was like or really about until looking it up, you know, after seeing it on the list of top movies. So I was like, hey, we should see this top movie none of us have seen. This might be the first movie we've covered where none of us have ever seen it before.
It's not just that. This is the darkest movie that we've talked about. And keep in mind, this came out in 1996. So what kind of movies were we watching at that time? We were kids, right? So it was all about animated movies and things like that. You know, growing up, I can learn to appreciate, your good gangster movies like The Goodfellas and all those things. But this is something that I think, Ryan, you already really got down to the nitty gritty. This is something that we would have not understood had we not watched it in 2019, because this is a movie that supposedly, and those that watched it, we will be talking about the other side of the fence, is based on true events. Note the sarcasm in that. But what did you guys think about that when the movie, you know, immediately started and you saw like, hey, they're trying to sell the realism in it? Did that get you into the experience?
Yes, it did, actually. And well, we'll get to that part later as far as what the actual true events really means. But I will be completely honest. The fact that it started with this is a true story really enhanced the movie for me. And then it wasn't until later finding out, maybe it's not as real as you thought. Then it's kind of like a little bit of a disappointment. But because the whole time you're watching it, you're thinking this craziness really happened, it did make me enjoy it more.
Mm-hmm. There's that old saying that truth is stranger than fiction. So setting that up in that way, like reminding you, hey, this really happened, almost set a higher expectation in the way that, okay, things must get really crazy in this movie if you're pointing that out at the very beginning. And sure enough, I'd say it delivers.
It also kind of stopped the whole thing when you're watching movies and you're like, oh, that would never happen, or that's unrealistic. It was kind of like a good way to buffer that.
I think that's exactly what they were going for, because when you combine that with the editing style, it seemed like they were trying to just tell a story. You know, with other movies, they try to have a lot of music and things going on. But to me, it just felt like here's this desperate man going through all these situations, and he has the worst luck, and Jerry sucks. You're going to be hearing that a lot throughout this episode, because you definitely get a feel for this guy, and in the worst way possible. And for context, the movie, if you go over to Rotten Tomatoes, and I have no doubt that this sort of persuaded Ryan into having us talk about it, it has 93%. So let's just say critics definitely enjoyed it. And when you look
critically
at the,
acclaimed.
Yeah, critically acclaimed. And when you go look at the user score, it's actually not that different, which is surprising, because I feel like when you look at this type of movie, it's not a niche genre, but I think you guys know what I'm saying. This is an acquired taste. This is not your Friday date night movie. You know, this is like in the American Psycho side of the fence. So before talking about the movie, what do you guys think about the Coen brothers? Do you have any prior experience to watching some of their movies?
I've always been very hot and cold when it comes to the Coen brothers. Like, I might get flack for this, but I didn't really think The Big Lebowski was all that great. It's kind of one of those movies that society has really put up on a pedestal. And it's one of those things where it's like, you need to like The Big Lebowski because culture says you need to like The Big Lebowski. I never really got into it. So on the other side of it, I really love No Country for Old Men. So they're very hit and miss for me.
So, oh boy, I look at the list here that Juan put. So just naming off some movies that the Coen brothers directed: True Grit, No Country for Old Men, The Big Lebowski, Burn After Reading. The only movie that I've seen on this list is Burn After Reading, and
really?
I stopped watching
really?
I stopped watching it halfway through because I didn't like it. So I really don't have much experience with Coen brothers movies, and I know probably No Country for Old Men and The Big Lebowski are definitely the biggest sins on this list for me not seeing. So that's something I'm definitely going to have to make up for sometime in the future.
And Keith, something that you mentioned there is very controversial, because I feel like from the moment that we decided to work on the show, we're probably video game first. Let's just be real about that. It's just
what
we usually play and watch. But when we talk about movies, and even when Ryan put, you know, Fargo, my first thought is, ooh, like, people say so many great things about this movie. What if we don't like it? You know, what's going to be that feedback? And, like, am I going to feel comfortable in having that conversation about, oh, wow, that's actually not a great movie? And
you gotta be
the same
bold,
can be said
Juan.
With, what?
You got to be bold.
Exactly.
No, I'm all about that. It's just like, these are movies, you know, we had a recent episode about underrated video games we never played, right? So there, it's a little bit different because there are games that were by default underappreciated. But here, the hype machine, even if 20, 30 years have gone by, it's always there. It's like, how dare you not watch that movie? This is the type of movie that people get pissed off if they found out that you haven't watched it. So having said that, starting it off with Mr. McNulty, give me your general impressions about Fargo.
I enjoyed it. A lot of these kind of crime type of movies do interest me. And I thought it was mainly about, it was weird in the way that I don't think there was really any characters that sort of changed over time. There wasn't really, you know, a lot of times like a movie's kind of all about a character's journey or anything, but this was a very kind of plot-driven movie that the characters were still interesting, but none of them really evolved. You know, the woman who's the cop is, you know, she's just a good-hearted cop who's doing the right thing, but you're still kind of, you're rooting for her, you're kind of attached to her character, and William H. Macy starts out as a scumbag and basically stays a scumbag the entire time. So pretty much you don't really see any characters evolve, yet you're still interested in them. And like I said, it's more about the plot moving forward than kind of anything else.
Mm-hmm. To me, it's more the events that took place opposed to the character development. And that's one thing about this movie that I really loved, how you saw the events kind of happen, and then there's almost like little side events that they don't bring up specifically that you as the watcher are left to fill in the blanks on that make you go like, oh, that's kind of crazy, or that's really nuts that something like that could happen. Or maybe in a field near me, there's almost $1 million somewhere in a hole. You never know, but it could be there. It leaves those nice little nuggets as you go through the movie. And one thing that maybe bugs most people about this movie, but I could actually get behind, were the accents. I personally fell in love with it. One kind of brought it up earlier. Like, for those that don't know, I grew up in Winnipeg, Manitoba, Canada. So North Dakota is like an hour drive south from me. I think Fargo specifically is about 3-4 hours, depending on how fast you go. I know at least 5 people growing up that almost sounded exactly like people talked in that movie. It's a little more characterized in this movie, a little more exaggerated, but they did a really good job with that. They did a very, very good job. It was almost unsettling and hard for me to get into.
It felt a little like home to
you? It felt a little too close for comfort.
See, that to me was so different because obviously that is just a stark different accent. You know, with Ryan, you don't really have like the traditional Boston accent, but maybe with every couple of words, something just kind of spills out. But generally
speaking,
we can do
Goodwill Hunting someday and you can get the real Boston accent.
We're going to have to do that. But I think that we are not bound by our stereotypical accents in the show. I think that should be our new tagline, unbound from stereotypical accents. But I remember the scene with the lady cop that is pregnant and she's talking to somebody and the accent and the entire dialogue. Oh yeah, when the car flips over and they find the car the day after. Like, I just started laughing because I cannot associate with the culture and the way that they were talking. So it's a completely different contrast to Keith saying it's hitting home. And to me, it's like, well, that is very different from my home.
But I love the way they portrayed it because you could tell so much without them putting it in your face, like the kind of culture that exists where these are they come off like the friendliest, nicest people. But at the same time, they're also really resilient. And probably a lot of that has to do with dealing with cold. Yeah, exactly. Dealing with that cold weather all the time. But it's like all these horrible things are happening and they stay so pleasant and like they're not really fazed by anything, really. You know, they're you know, doing a murder scene, except for the pregnant lady. When she getting sick, it's the morning sickness because she's pregnant. It's not because she's looking at dead bodies or anything, you know. So that's almost like the funniest thing is that's what's getting her sick versus the crime scene that she's dealing with. So yeah, like I said, they don't outright talk about how tough they are or whatever, but it's just shown like they're just friendly people that horrible things are happening and they're just kind of like, oh yeah, you know, that happened, like the guy calling in the murder or whatever, or the that you know, the guy who's telling the story that he said that there was a murder or something when he's talking, he's
Ryan,
reporting the story.
They've seen some things before that, but with everything that you mentioned, and I don't know if you guys have thought about this, because when I was going into the movie, and then we'll be talking about the actors, etc., I was expecting a drama. I saw the trailer because I love to watch these earlier trailers that seem very rough cut. They're not the traditional trailers that we see now with music all over the place. I'm like, okay, you know, a murder happened, and then it's going to be the suspense of like the investigation. But then I watched the movie, and to me, instead of a drama, this is a horror film. And I'm not saying that in a bad way. Like, I was quickly reminded of Jason, Freddy, and everything else, because when you look at the violence, especially when you look at the bad guys, that is so like theatrical. That is so much like a villain, not a bad person. It's like a straight up villain that you would see in a horror film or in a superhero movie. So, did you guys feel that at any point with Fargo?
I didn't really feel like it was a horror movie, although I can see kind of the aspects. Definitely towards the end of the movie, you did worry for what is her name? Marge? Was that her name? I feel
wife.
Like we should actually know her name because she's
I only know
one of
the three
main
characters.
Yeah.
Well, I would say Marge is one of the main characters, but you did kind of fear for her in that style of, you know, because that they established the other, that big criminal guy. I forget what his name is in the movie, but
Gayer. It's a G-A-E-A-R. I don't know how you say that.
I don't even know.
We'll call him the big guy.
Yeah, the big guy. You know, he had proven himself to be pretty dangerous, so you did feel like he might have had something up his sleeve, but it's like, nope, she pretty much just catches him in the act and then is able to arrest him. Other than that, it just felt more, just more like kind of a crime, not necessarily drama, but I guess a crime drama just kind of unfolding, almost just like a wackier episode of like Criminal Minds or NCIS or something.
Yeah, I would agree that it falls more under the crime drama umbrella. That end of it did feel a bit like a horror movie where it's the one of the protagonists of the movie facing the killer alone. But because it was so event-driven and not character-driven, that really takes out the horror film aspect of it for me. And that's where it falls under crime drama, just because it's all about the events of the crime and everything that spirals out of control from it.
So with the movie, as Ryan mentioned, you know, the wife is, she is the plot twist, I guess, because she's the one that gets kidnapped. But the main character is played by William Macy, and the character is Jerry Lundegaard. So he needs a little bit of money. So the movie immediately starts out by him arranging this meeting with two people, one of them played by Steve Buscemi, who plays Carl Showalter. And Steve Buscemi, if you guys don't know who he is, I mean, he is a movie staple. I feel like when you talk about underrated actors, he's got to be in the top five because he's always great at what he does.
Underrated, but most recognizable, let's say.
Right?
Because there is not another human being on this planet that looks like Steve Buscemi.
That's true. I think he has gotten more appreciation
in recent years,
like because of things like Boardwalk Empire, where he could finally star in something. I feel like Steve Buscemi never gets to get a starring role. So Boardwalk Empire was a great way to kind of give him that prominence. Of course, he's great in a lot of, you know, like Tarantino movies, too. But I thought he was great in this movie.
Yeah, so he's one of them, and he's like, he plays Steve Buscemi, let's be real. He does not play anything that's too far away from that. And then on the complete opposite side of the fence, we have Peter Stormer playing as Mr. Grimsrud, which, come on, I'm talking about horror movies. His name is Grimsrud. And I know I had seen him before, so I looked up his biography. He's been in American Gods, 22 Jump Street, so I think that's maybe where I saw him.
Yeah, he looked super familiar to me, too, and I figured I saw him from 22 Jump Street as well.
But it's interesting because, to me, between the three characters, right, you have not the good guy, because technically there's no good people in this movie. Everybody's kind of a dick or an asshole or clueless. Well, the cops, but they are the vessel that transition everything out, but they're not the
regular
main characters.
Townsfolk are all the heroes. It's but any characters involved in the crime, there's no saving any of them.
Yeah, it's none like they're all a bunch of criminals.
Yeah, yeah. So then Peter, he plays this, it's almost like he's Bane because he never talks in the movie. And then whenever he talks, it's like you really got to pay attention to him. And I love
the
dynamic. Oh, man, dude.
You're talking about the man.
Hey, it's also cold weather. I see a lot of similarities. So maybe they paid tribute to him in the Batman movies. But talking first about the main character, Jerry Lundegaard. What do you guys think about him? Not the acting. I want to talk about the character. In other words, like the situation that he got himself in and how he definitely made it worse. Like, how did you feel about that?
Jerry Lundegaard is literal human trash. And they do such a good job of building this character that thinks he's in control, thinks he has it all figured out, but can't handle the pressure. And I think that's what they landed so perfectly about Jerry's character, where he's like, oh yeah, I'm the salesman. But they even take a while in the beginning to establish that he's a sleazy salesman that's only out for himself. And then when things don't go his way, he almost goes into a temper tantrum. They want you to hate Jerry from the second he is on screen. And they do that perfectly.
Yep, absolutely. I mean, from the moment he sits down to make that deal, even like the criminals who he's making the deal with are questioning, like, you're gonna have someone kidnap your own wife? Like even
what the hell's wrong with you?
Yeah, even they're like, what the hell's wrong with this guy? Yeah, everything embedded in his character is just scumbag. The fact that his occupation is a car salesman, which the foundation of that job is pretty much embedded in telling lies to people. So just everything about him makes him completely irredeemable. He's cowardly. He's out for himself and nobody else. And he also is not good at what he does. So there you go. There's pretty much nothing to like about him.
So I think that Jerry is the bigger reason why they had to, at the beginning of the movie, say this is based on a true story, because the acting and the performance and what the character actually is, it's just sold so perfectly, because here's somebody that is useless. Like, as Keith put it, he's trash. Like, this is the bottom of the barrel human being that wants the
easy
way out.
What is it
with
Jerry's, right? I mean, look at Rick and Morty, you know?
Wow. Yeah, exactly.
It's true.
Hey, who knows? Maybe we're onto something there, but the fact that, you know, you see him as the car salesman and he can't even get that right, because that scene, I had this level of cringe where he's trying to sell this
True Coat.
Yeah, what was it?
True Coat.
The True
like
Coat,
the,
yeah.
The it comes, seal, yeah.
It comes embedded into the car, and I just wanted to punch him in the face. And you know, a movie is really good when they're making you want to physically get up and punch the character in the face and have him bleed. So, William, you did an awesome mm-hmm. job there. So, what do you guys think of the entire aspect of? So, there's this father-in-law that he's got all the money. So, the idea is that they are going to kidnap Jerry's wife and hold her for ransom for $80,000, and then he would split the $80,000, $40,000 for the two bad guys. So that's Carl and Grimstrud, and then $40,000 for himself. This is where we go into spoiler territory, but everybody watching and listening, I would assume, you know, we're going to be talking about spoilers. So things go off the rails, not just in the podcast, things go off the rails, and then it goes from 50-50 to like, no, the bad guys need all the money because people end up dying. The father-in-law, who decides to actually hand the money himself instead of Jerry, he ends up getting killed. So the parking lot attendant gets killed. Everybody gets killed in the movie except Jerry. So it is a very dark path. At no point, if you're having a bad day, this is not a movie to watch. And I was having a bad day when I watched this movie.
Well, I mean, it's got some funny moments to it. You know, just the conversations that the townsfolk have, it kind of puts that light spin on everything that's going on because it's so crazy. But the plot itself, I mean, even to put on top of, you know, Jerry's a scumbag, they don't outwardly say it, but if you catch it, right, that Jerry's telling the criminals that it's $80,000, right? But Jerry's telling his father that they're asking for $1 million so that he can get even more money to walk away with.
He's the worst.
And of course, you see Steve Buscemi figuring that out when he actually gets his hands on that suitcase. But yeah, just a completely poorly executed plan. Obviously, William H. Macy, Jerry, his character, you know, it seems like his plan, it's not horribly laid out, but the people involved, the criminals, when you have Grimsrud, he's really the X factor that spirals everything into true madness. Jerry's no mastermind, but there's a chance things could have worked if he had more sound people doing the job, you know?
It's true. And Jerry's really the thing that sold this whole based on a true story idea, just from the way that everything played out and the type of character that he was. It almost feels like something, some insane story that you would hear on the 6 o'clock news. And because of that one piece, because of Jerry, that's really sold it.
Yeah, it's definitely true, because this is, even though this story didn't exactly happen, it's not uncommon for people to seek the wealth of relatives. It's probably one of the bigger motivations for crime that happens within, you know, a family itself.
And let's be real. In 2019, when you look at all the situations that have happened with mothers, I forget the true story, but my wife and I are watching the series right now based on the mother that, you know, she kept her daughter, you know, making it think she's got cancer and everything else.
The act or whatever. My girlfriend just watching that. Yeah.
Think about the fact that that's based on something that legitimately happened. So when you look at that and you look at this, it's like, you know what? I would not doubt.
It's very believable, basically. Yep. Yeah.
So the other aspect of this movie, the world is terrible. The world is, Keith, just stay in your home, please. Can you please do that?
I will hide under my bed.
You go ahead and do that. But the other thing that I wanted to say, and this always comes up when we talk about movies in this podcast, because it happened with The Matrix, is the aspect of communication. Because, okay, so the whole thing is the kidnapping. That was going to happen, but then Jerry tricks his father-in-law into this deal that he thinks is going to lead to all the money in the world, but then he figures out, hey, that doesn't actually pan out. But at some point, he tries to contact, you know, Steve Buscemi and the other character in Grimrod to sort of call everything off, but he has no way of actually contacting them, which nowadays could be solved with a text, could be solved in all sorts of ways. But think about the fact that he sits down with these two guys. He goes over all the details, but then after that, it's not up until he gets the call and the wife has already been kidnapped that everything else actually unfolds. So there could have been a scenario where he calls everything off and nobody wants to really be involved in everything. Did you guys, even though it's like a very insignificant portion of the film, because it takes place in like 3-4 minutes, it's a pretty big deal. What did you think about that middle point before the kidnapping actually happened?
I think it's a good way to kind of to establish again how not in control Jerry is and how what a bad idea it was for him to do something so irrational. Kind of just jump the gun and do something like this before even really trying all, you know, other alternative methods of acquiring this money. And again, the movie, even though it came out in 1996, is actually taking place in the 80s. So that makes communication even more difficult. If it's 96, you'd say, oh, maybe he might have a cell phone. But, you know, even though there were cell phones in the 80s, they were way less common. So that just makes it really difficult to be able to reach anyone that, you know, at this point, Jerry has no idea how to find these guys.
Yeah, and it just was a great character building thing about how in control Jerry wasn't, even though he thought he was, because that little scene that happens where he comes home and he's looking around, he's like, I guess this already happened. Okay, didn't know this was happening today. And then trying to figure it out, trying to work through it, sitting in front of the phone and trying to really plan out to make it sound believable. That was really great character development.
That's when you realize just how messed up he is, because, yeah, he's this desperate guy. And this is where editing comes to play, because notice in that part where he's sort of practicing, you know, how he's going to have the call, they only play his sound, but they don't yet show him on screen. So I was thinking like, okay, he actually cares, you know, it's like, no, he's just standing in front of the phone practicing, like, be too sad. But then the little detail, you know, he's already going into the shtick, but it's like the secretary. So it's like, oh, yes, please. Can you transfer the call? It's like, super fine. Your wife just got kidnapped. And she actually got kidnapped, which is the thing that amazes me about the character. Because let's think about that for a second. He is actually married, right? His wife actually got kidnapped. So these are two guys that he has no idea who they are. They can do whatever they want with her, yet here he is in front of a phone just practicing. Like, I thought that was like a little thing that once again added more character. Like, yeah, he's an idiot, but this is just a sick human
being.
He's
like a sociopath. Yeah. I'm glad you pointed out. That's just such a great moment. You know, you're sitting there, you kind of just see a shot. You don't see him in the shot and you just hear him repeating it. And you're kind of like, why the hell is he saying the same thing over and over again? And then you see, oh, yeah. But yeah, beautiful moment of just really showing what a scumbag he is. And then on the flip side, I feel like with Marge, when she has that dinner with her old friend, you know, it doesn't factor in at all to really anything else in the story. But that was kind of like the flip side of showing, oh, you know, she's a good person. The second he even like tries to even make any type of advance, she's making him back off and just showing that she's just a nice, loyal person. And, you know, even after that, she's not yelling at him. She's just very forgiving of him and just trying to help him out. So another kind of a flip side character moment for one of the redeemable and nice characters.
I think that what I liked about that is with this movie, and I feel like that's why I like a lot of 80s and 90s like gangster flicks, they have a lot of scenes that honestly don't add much to the actual plot, but they add more to the character. Like with that, it's almost like showing, hey, you know, things are about to happen, but these are just people. Like with the cop lady, they didn't need to show any of her personal life at any point. It would not change the plot in any way. But the fact that they show you that makes you think, because I was thinking about that, oh, she's going to die. There is no way she does not die in the movie. So then my perspective about it changed. And I feel like this gets lost now because this is not a 5-hour film. It is on the lengthier side because it's almost 2 hours long. It's like an hour 30, hour 55 or something like that. But I feel that that got lost as movies became more mainstream and cleaner. Keith, did you like that about movies in the 80s and 90s where they sort of lent themselves more to the characters rather than sometimes the overall plot?
If done right, yes. Because, I don't know, to me, I guess it doesn't really matter. It's if you have a story to tell and you tell it properly, whether it be through more event-driven things or more character-driven things, then great. But just have a little respect for my time and do it properly. So I guess it comes down to it doesn't really matter.
Okay. So then here's the big question, because I feel like if we can't answer this and everybody watching and listening, it's hard to take this movie seriously. As I mentioned, you know, we've had horrible, horrible, effed up things happen in 2019, the past couple of years, so nothing should surprise us. But the premise of the movie is, I'm desperate for money, how far will I go? And in this case, it's kidnapping your wife. Have you guys ever had such a situation? Obviously,
well, nothing that extreme.
I mean, I'm the
Jesus.
Only married one, so like, I'm looking at my wife right now. I will not have you be kidnapped for money, okay? I'm just clarifying that right now. She's playing Overwatch. She has no idea what I'm saying. But the premise of this struggle, have you guys had any kind of situation that you're like, man, I got to do some stuff for money that you can legally talk about?
Yeah, you might want to define that a little bit, hey? I mean, nothing to this extreme. I've worked a weekend I wanted to take off for money. I guess I've been privileged that way. I've never had to fake kidnaps for money or do stuff with my body for money, so I guess I'm doing pretty good.
You could.
Yeah, I would consider that a win. Really, the only time where it's like, and it's not even I was desperate for money, but it's like, you know, one summer after I graduated college, I played the lottery a lot in hopes that maybe I don't have to have a real life and I could just win the lottery and call it a day. But I don't think I've ever been in a situation where I'm literally, you know, there hasn't been someone to just help me out, you know, exactly. I've never been like on the street needing money. Very fortunately, I haven't been in a situation like that.
So what you guys think about the villains in the
Where
movie?
Where do you go from there? I'm sorry.
No, but okay, think about
to
it this
bad
way.
Guys.
From the moment that the film starts, if you can't buy the fact, because I guarantee you, somebody, go all the way back to 1996, not now. Go back to 96, when somebody watched based on true events and they saw the kidnapping, I guarantee you they still went like, that's not going to happen. But we've seen things happen that are honestly worse than this and involve kidnapping and involve
for sure.
money.
Because unless my timeline's wrong, in 1996, this was before the boom of like crime scene television shows. Like I think Law and Order was around then, but you didn't have your CSIs or Criminal Minds.
There's been some that have been around forever, but crime shows are the most popular shows in America. America, for some reason, has an obsession with crime.
SVU, man. I'm an SVU. Yeah. Okay, I'm sorry.
Practice.
Naturally, this has to happen. Law and Order or CSI?
Law and Order, 100%.
Okay. Yeah, Law and Order.
Okay, now within the Law and Order cinematic universe, television
Special Victims
universe.
Unit.
Okay,
yeah,
SVU,
Agreed.
It's all about Ice-T. It's Ice-T and then everybody else that plays on Law and Order.
I'm glad we had this 30-second break. Now get to talking about what you guys think about the villain's role in the enjoyment of the movie. We know what happens, right? The events, but they add so much personality that I feel like nobody else really brings to the table, especially when you talk about the contrasting styles. I remember one part, Steve Buscemi's character, and I laughed out loud because the other guy doesn't talk, right? So then Steve Buscemi says, like, I've been listening to the crap all this week or all this time. I'm like, the guy hasn't said anything. Yeah. What is going on? What did you think about that?
It was a really good dynamic. If you go back to the Home Alone episode and I talk about how there should be like a dark, gritty version of Home Alone, like this is what I imagine the dark version of the Wet Bandits to be, where it's the mouthpiece and the action guy. And another strong issue of character development with the big guy, I'm not even going to try saying his name, where they do such a good job of establishing him as a stone cold killer. Like, does in that scene where they're on the side of the road and he doesn't even like hesitate or have a second guess, like, boom, I just shot a state trooper in the head. These two people drove by, now they need to die. He is a stone cold killer, and they do such a good job about that. And then you almost have his the yin to his yang in Steve Buscemi, where he's like a bit of a mouthpiece, a smaller yappy, and he's the one that's always screwing up and getting them into those situations that the big guy needs to quote unquote fix, but his version of fixing is just extremely psychotic. It was great.
Yeah, I completely echo Keith there. It was a great dynamic of just having the small loudmouth and the strong silent guy. They just complement each other so well. And I'm a sucker for Steve Buscemi. I just always find his character so entertaining. And it was, yeah, I didn't expect the, you know, the big guy to be as crazy. You figured he'd be like the calmer, more calculated, and he is in a way, but not in the way that I expected.
Yeah, really.
And I like that because I didn't know how far they would go with the movie, especially with the scene that Keith mentioned. They get pulled over by a cop, right? And then they have the wife in the back, and then she starts yelling. So the moment the cop suspects that there's somebody back there, the Peter's character just grabs his head, pops a shot in his head, and then just blood comes gushing out. And that was not, I was not ready for that.
Yeah,
at all.
The movie does not prepare you for that at all. It's very out of the left field, blue, whatever word I'm going for there.
Some kind of play. So yeah. What was your favorite moment in the movie? Not necessarily scene, could be a dialogue, could be any kind of thing. What was your favorite? Starting with Ryan. The picker.
For me, I would probably say my favorite moment was just, you know, Marge investigating the crime scene and just kind of putting the pieces together while she's just having this casual conversation with the other guy. He's just standing back with his coffee, and just how casual they are about it. A lot of those just conversations were so funny to me because, like I said, they were just so calm. So much chaos had happened. There's dead bodies all around them, including a state trooper. And they're just kind of, it's like everyday business, you know? They're not, you know, it's not like we're CSI where they're all walking around. They're like, what do we have? You know, blah, blah, blah. You know, it's such a different pace of their...
It's true.
You know, they're so calm and chill. And it was so amusing, you know, just that juxtaposition to the craziness and the darker side of the movie.
If I had to choose one, it would probably be the scene between Marge and Jerry, the second time that she goes to the car dealership, and just that whole dynamic of it starts out as a friendly conversation, and then as it goes on, Jerry starts to become more unglued and starts to feel more guilt, and you can see the look on Marge's face, her expression change as she realizes, like, oh, this guy might have something to do with this. And Jerry slowly kind of digging his own grave in that respect, to the point where he needs to drive away and flee the scene and basically admit guilt and go on the run. Just that conversational dynamic where they don't really say it outright.
Jerry meltdown.
Exactly. See him meltdown. That was probably my favorite part of the movie.
My favorite scene was also in the car dealership. It was when he found out, and I may be getting things mixed up, but he gets the first call regarding the kidnapping and things just going from bad to worse, but hangs up. But then he gets another call, and it's that he had sent some documents with some serial numbers that were sort of scribbled out. So they've been calling him back and forth and just saying, like, you know, please send me this information, please send me it. And he doesn't do that. And it's the contrast, right? That they say, like, hey, you know, if, like, we're going to get the lawyers on your ass if you don't actually get this together. And then he hangs up, and there's this moment of silence because he's not overly dramatic. He's just kind of standing there. And then before you know it, there's no music playing that I remember. He just grabs the keyboard or the computer, starts smashing everything. And I thought that was very real. I feel with a lot of movies, they would immediately have him, you know, zoom into, like, this overly dramatic expression. But even like for us, he was still smiling seconds before that. He was like, hey, you know, it's just me, good old Jerry. You know, how can I help you? I will fax that over. No, I'm gonna send that over. And then he hangs up, and then the character comes off, and in comes the desperate human being. And I love that because really it was a one-man scene. If you think about it, there was nobody else that we were seeing visually. So that really just sold me on the acting for William Macy. And then
H. Macy. You got to put the H in there.
Yeah, I know. I'm sorry. The H is important, man. It's silent. But anything that just made you want to go, ugh, or why, or this does not hold up from Fargo?
Well, I mean, there's the accents. I think that's the obvious one where it made me go, ugh, because they did a real good job with it. Almost too good. Don't you know?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
I don't feel like this movie was dated at all. Nothing took me out of it, to be honest. And kind of, I guess we'll get into the whole true story quotation marks about it. The fact that it wasn't till I found out after the fact just goes, you know, is a testament to its believability, even with how crazy it gets.
But no, just to reiterate what Ryan said, this movie on its own, without knowing any of that, this movie still holds up. It is a movie that could be watched today and can be highly recommended.
Yeah, I feel like with maybe other movies, this is going to be a scary topic of, does it deserve the acclaim that it received? And with this one, I feel like, yeah. Like, honestly, 100%. I have watched other Coen Brothers stuff. They're cool. Like, they're a good movie. So with this one, I finished watching it, and I kept thinking about it. And I kept thinking about it. Like, man, just think about that. Because I can't help but put myself in his shoes. Like, I would never make mistakes like that, but would I? I mean, you don't know, right? You don't have that. So you think about all these hypothetical scenarios. And as Ryan mentioned, the idea is that this is based on a true story until now. We need to read the entire thing here because it is fascinating to read and then to figure out what happened. So credit goes out to sbs.com.au. And they wrote the following. During the promotion During the promotion for Fargo, Joel Coen told Premiere, we wanted to try something based on a real story and tell it in a way that was very pared down. He even went so far as to say that the events depicted on screen were pretty close to what actually happened. So this is a marketing mumbo jumbo. This is before the movie comes out. Turns out it was all a press tour spin. In the introduction to the published screenplay, brother Ethan gave the game away when he wrote that the film pretends to be true. Just last year, as of the publishing of this article, he commented, we wanted to make a movie just in the genre of a true story movie. I'll read this part again. He wanted to make a movie that is in the genre of a true story movie. You don't have to have a true story to make a true story movie. This isn't Juan saying this. This is a quotation. Even so, Fargo did take inspiration from two real-life events. One, a General Motors Finance Corporation employee who committed fraud by playing around with serial numbers, and we see that. I actually just mentioned that as one of my favorite scenes. The other was the murder of Hell Crafts. Man, these names are all over the place. Hell broke loose, a Connecticut woman whose husband killed her and disposed of her body by putting it in a wood chipper. And we actually see something like that at the end of the movie, because the Steve Buscemi character wants to split some of the stuff, but then things
he
go
gets
sour.
Split.
Yeah, he actually ends up getting split. Beyond that, the story is made up. Joel told the Huffington Post. Ryan.
I mean, they're based on two stories that are true, so I guess that kind of counts.
I gotta ask Ryan first, as the person that selected this, having watched the movie, and you mentioned that you found out about this afterwards, did it change how you felt about the movie, or what happened there?
It was definitely a little bit disappointing to find out, oh, they straight up lied, and they, like, but then I kind of understand their technique. It was a good way to put you in that world and really buy in. So is it a cheap technique? I would say, heck yes, it is. But it worked on me. And the fact that my first experience with it was positive, and I stayed grounded within the world, and it didn't take me out of it because I went in believing it was true. You know, am I a little disappointed? Sure, but I felt like it didn't ruin the movie that much for me. And if I saw it again, I feel like it wouldn't ruin it either. So it was very genius. It twisted my mind around it a little bit and got me to buy in. And now I feel like it won't really take me out of it if I watch it again.
Yeah, and I mean, movies have done a lot worse when it comes to stuff like this. I don't really think it's all that egregious. Like, yes, they're stretching the concept of based on a true story a little bit, but it's believable.
They stretch it a lot, but that's okay.
Well, I guess. I mean, it's like I jokingly said, it's based on two stories that are true, really, and they just use fiction to tie them together. There are movies that have done a hell of a lot worse, but because you believe it, they do such a good job that you believe it without knowing that. I think it almost makes up for it in the way that they had so much confidence in this story and willing to depict that it almost forgives it a little bit in my mind.
Yeah, even though it's deceiving, ultimately we felt exactly what they wanted to feel, what they wanted us to feel, right? Because from the moment that it starts to the moment that it ends, I got the sense that after reading this, like when they said, you know, we wanted to make a movie in the genre of a true story movie, that is exactly how it felt. And I felt cheated. I'm like, damn, I actually fell into their trap.
Yeah,
to perfection.
Yeah,
we all did.
Yeah, we all did indeed. But any closing comments or impressions about Fargo, considering this is considered by many one of the top 10, top 15 movies of all time?
I was just pleasantly surprised that you guys enjoyed it. I wasn't really sure how you guys were going to feel about it. I definitely enjoyed it. So I'm glad to see us all see a movie that none of us has seen before and come out with a positive outlook on it.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad that I got to see that movie, and going forward, happy to recommend it and be able to see that I've seen it and seen another Coen brothers movie that I can get behind, because now it gives me a little more understanding of what makes them as regarded as they are.
Yeah, same here. I think my favorite thing about this movie and what I really left with it is that if you notice, this is a straight up thing going all the way to the beginning with Ryan, with what Ryan said in the show. Every character is one-dimensional. At no point does anybody really change. You just get to see who they really are. So more so than a movie, it almost felt like a thrill ride. Like, this is the event that happened, and you're just going to watch that unfold. It doesn't have the traditional movie formula in the sense that, oh, well, Jerry at some point is going to become a good guy and regret what he does. The nope. only thing that he regrets is not getting the money that he wanted for he wanted. It's not mm-hmm. the fact that he's not getting his wife. He's not hating that. His father-in-law died, yet he's still a bad human being. And I feel like a lot of movies nowadays are a little afraid to delve into that. Like, people can just be bad in a movie. And that doesn't mean that they mm-hmm. got to have this thing at the end. It's like, oh, no, but later he regretted his decisions.
Another
like,
thing...
Nope.
Another thing that they don't even touch on in the movie and you're left to realize is that Jerry just left his son at home. He abandoned yeah. a child just to yeah. go on the run.
I'm sure the cops will eventually come for the child. And also, it's kind of sad how the wife also is just kind of unceremoniously killed off screen. But I think they probably just didn't want to make it feel even darker. Because yeah. I think that they kind of did that to lighten it up a little bit, just have her kind of die off screen. But then, of course, they just leave you with, hey, that money's buried somewhere.
Yeah, you know, so it's not
whatever,
a perfect ending.
Literally nothing.
You technically don't get closure. Think about that. Like, none of the movie actually gets solved because the money, as you mentioned, it's over here. The father-in-law got killed. Jerry's taken away, but you don't know what happens with the kid. We don't know what happens there. The wife, she died on... Like, it's just yeah. about the experience, not so much the conclusion of the movie. And once again, very different yeah. to everything
in
else.
In a way, justice is kind of served because nobody gets that money. All that fighting and everything, not even the... The dad who it was his money. He doesn't even get his money back. You know, it's just gone.
In a field. Buried.
Yeah. So for everybody watching and listening, please send us an email to acastofthepast@gmail.com or join our Discord channel, acastofthepast.com/Discord. I would love to know what are other movies that is within this genre of they wanted to make a movie in the genre of a true story movie. What is another incredible true story movie that you'd like us to talk about? Because this is up my alley. This is something that I like because I get to thinking about the thought process of the main character, and I think it would be awesome to see other stuff like that and talk about it on the channel. But as always, we have a little bit of trivia. Not a lot this week because it's a fairly dark movie, but it's interesting to see a couple of things. So, Mr. McNulty, could you deal with the Fargo trivia/facts?
Fun facts.
All right. So the first one we have, the actors used a book called How to Talk Minnesotan. Wait, how to, Minnesotan. That's a
Minnesotan.
Weird word to say.
Minnesotan.
To help with their accents. And I'll take Keith's word for it that they were definitely convincing.
Good. Like I yeah. said, I know at least 4 or 5 people in my life that talk exactly like that. So good on them.
Yeah, you can see some movies where it's really not good. Like, I think it might be, it's some movie, I think about JFK, and it has Billy Bob Thornton and his, I think it's about the Cuban Missile Crisis. It's not the JFK movie ever about the assassination. It's about the Cuban Missile Crisis. And his boss, he's supposed to have a Boston accent, and it's just not good. But then you'll watch, like, Good Will Hunting. And it's pretty good. So there's a lot of movies, even if they're highly regarded, sometimes they don't get the accents right. I think this movie, they definitely made an effort to really try and nail that. All right. So for our next one, we have William H. Macy begged the directors for the role of Jerry. He did 2 readings for the part and became convinced he was the best man for the role. When the Coens didn't get back to him, he flew to New York, where they were starting production, and said, I'm very worried that you're going to screw up this movie by giving this role to somebody else. It's my role, and I'll shoot your dogs if you don't give it to me. He was joking, of course.
You know what? From that last joke, he is perfect for the role of Jerry Lundegaard.
Yep.
He probably said it in the style of Jerry.
I'll shoot your dogs there. How about that?
Did this movie win any awards? I don't know if we can
check that out. Check that out meanwhile. Yeah. But while you do that, just a couple quick things going on. And something that we're proud to announce is that there's this platform called Ko-fi. But I love to say it is Ko-fi because it is
K-O-F-I.
kidnappingfi.com. And it's a pretty simple platform that you can give back to your creators. Unlike Patreon, this is pretty much as straightforward. The concept is it's the equivalent of, hey, do you like a content creator? Give him a cup of coffee, you know, buy him a cup of coffee. It's like a tip. So if you guys enjoy what we do on the podcast and you want to give back in a more direct way, that's one of the great ways to go about it. So a short URL is acastofthepast.com/Kofi. So K-O-F-I. Easiest way to remember, if you're a fan of wrestling, Kofi Kingston, you're never going to forget that. acastofthepast.com/Kofi, K-O-F-I. Whatever, if you want to donate at some point, we will definitely give you a shout out because it's the least that we can do. Seriously. All you guys are simply put awesome. Ryan, did I fill in enough time so you could?
You did. That was perfect. I got awesome. The awards. So it's gotten quite a number of awards, but looking strictly at the Academy Awards, the Oscars, Frances McDormand, who played Marge, she won Best Actress that year. All right. And the Coen brothers won Best Original Screenplay. So this original screenplay might somewhat give away the whole based on a true story thing. And then for nominations, Ethan Coen was nominated for Best. They were nominated for Best Picture, Best Director nomination, and William H. Macy got a Best Supporting Actor nomination. So well deserved for all around on those.
Well deserved indeed. I'm very excited to be looking at all these movies later on. So once again, people, we do have the Discord channel. You can definitely check that out. Something else that we do want to give a shout out and show some love to, Keith, we have an Apple or iTunes podcast review, because if you check us out on YouTube, you can definitely hit the subscribe button. For anybody that reads or that leaves a review, even if it's a one-star review, even if you only want to talk smack about Keith, if there's no cursing, we may read it on the show. But luckily, this is a good one.
Comes even to if us there from, is, might even throw one of those beeps in there, you know, like the he's a beep guy.
Keith, you've opened up Pandora's box, man, so I'd be a little bit careful about that if I were you. So without further ado, what's Sparrow Wolf got to say, my friend?
Sparrow Wolf says, if you are an individual between the ages of 25 and 45, these guys will certainly take you through memory lane. They are promoting a dynamic approach to topics and are quite active through all social media outlets that we are. If, like me, the past more times than not makes you smile, then this cast and its crew are for you. Video games, movies, podcasts, events, and much have all my interests so far as a good concept to think and share about.
Yeah. Keith, you got through that sentence paragraph, man. I'm proud of you.
Yeah.
So once again,
yeah, I sure did. It didn't take any editing time at all.
No editing whatsoever. It just sounded seamless. This was live, ladies and gentlemen. But yeah, we really want to be able to communicate with everybody as much as possible. So whenever we promote the Discord, it's not just like a, hey, we have a Discord channel, so use. It's like, this is actually what helps build the show. We have a suggestions part, and a lot of what we're doing in the show is a result of all that. So once again, if you leave a review, we will most definitely read it here, because it's an awesome thing. Makes us feel awesome. So thank you, everybody.
To show appreciation for those that go out of their way.
Yeah man. So Mr. McNulty, who wrote Katamari? Who wrote Katamari Debashi like that?
That wasn't
I
me.
Did on the agenda, okay?
Oh,
because
boy.
It didn't matter, because I just have to read it, okay?
Okay. So, Ryan, what do we got coming up, buddy? Including with Katamari, right.
Before it was so rudely Demasi? Interrupted here. We got coming up on April 14th, we're going to do another episode of Off the Rails. So those are kind of once a month, we do a free-form discussion where we catch up on whatever's going on in our lives. And a lot of times we'll talk about sort of newer media that we've consumed, whether it's video games, movies, or TV, or anything like that. April 21st, we're going to be covering one of my personal favorite movies ever. I know Juan loves this movie too. Office Space, a all-time classic, so I'm excited to talk about that
I'll finally be
movie.
Able to say I've seen it.
Oh my, I so still this, can't the, get
hey,
over this.
This will actually make for a great episode, though.
I'm scared.
The fact that, you know, Juan and I love it so much, and Keith has never seen it, you're going to really get two very different perspectives on the movie. And maybe, I'm sure Juan and I will have different views as well.
And then on May 5th, there was a poll for it, and you'll find out what it is soon. We will be playing the winner of the poll for underrated video game. So we will be playing one of the following games, and it is Katamari Damacy, Psychonauts, Midnight Club 3, or Legacy of Kain: Soul Reaver. We'll be announcing that on a future episode, what the winner was, but we will be playing one of those games on May 5th and talking about it then.
Yeah, it's worth pointing out, whenever you're listening to this, the poll has already ended, but for future episodes, we definitely go to Twitter, which is twitter.com/acastofthepast, and that's where we put the poll. So every couple of weeks, whether it's a movie, I mean, we did that with The Breakfast Club, for example. That was a fan-suggested thing, and it ended up happening. The polls are the best way. It's like, let's just say we don't mind playing any of these four games, right? It's like, honestly, I would have a pretty good time. I never played Midnight Club 3. I think I played the first one, Legacy of Kain: Soul Reaver. Did you ever play Legacy of Kain, Keith? I forget.
Nope, haven't touched any of them.
I played like an hour of it.
So exactly, it's like a really good opportunity to just sort of catch up on all these older games that may or may not hold up. But then everybody watching and listening, you guys are the ones that really get to decide. So Keith,
yes.
Because I feel like this has been such, not a negative episode. I love the discussion that we had, but this is such a negative and dark
thing. It's
been a very
positive episode. I think it definitely gave some light on this movie, this dark cloud.
Keith, could you send us off with like just a positive message for life?
Every day is a new smile waiting to happen. So while you're listening to this, please end this episode with a smile. And hey, why don't you come on back? And maybe next week we'll have a new episode of a cast
to the
past. Hey!
I stole your thing. Hey. That was for last week. That was for last time. You deserved that.
Fine.
I win. Ha.
Fine. Thanks for listening, everybody.